Dupuytren's contracture or disease is a hand disorder with shortening and thickening of the complex fascial structure extending from palm to fingers. It generally progresses slowly. Sometimes it never deteriorates and remains as solid nodules in the palm. Occasionally, surgical treatment may be needed when the hand functions deteriorate. You will find the information on this disorder, current treatment methods, and my comments in this video. Hi, I'm Dr. Gürkan. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and I will explain Dupuytren's contracture and the latest treatment methods from the point of view of an orthopedic surgeon. It was described in 1777. However, it is known as Dupuytren's contracture or disease after Guillaume Dupuytren revealed the details of the disorder in 1831. There are several different information about how often it occurs. Some reviews report 8% and higher rates, while others state lower. It is probably only in cases where the very early stages of the disease are considered. There is also a genetic predisposition. In other words, when it happens to someone in the family, it happens a little more often in close relatives than in ordinary people. It happens more often in older ages. High alcohol consumption, diabetes, advanced age, and long-term use of vibrating tools can cause this disorder. This is reported as high as 34% in type 1 diabetes or insulin-dependent diabetes and 25% in type 2 diabetes, which can be controlled with drugs. It is initially noticeable as solid stiff nodules in the palm. Although it is mostly painless, nodules in the palm may cause discomfort to the patient in manual work. In later periods, the bands that extend to fingers accompany the pathology. The stiffness increases and the fingers start to contracture. At this stage, the patient has difficulty in daily manual work. They have difficulty grasping things. Even at this stage, pain is usually absent. Although the ring finger and the little finger of the hand are most commonly affected, there may be accompanying nodules, but less frequently in the middle finger, thumb and index finger. It has been shown that when the angle of the fingers with the metacarpal bones reaches 53 degrees or the flexion of the fingers reaches 73 degrees, there is significant impairment in hand functions. You may not understand what these degrees mean. There is a more practical way to understand it. Desktop testing is the easiest method. If the hand is contracted so much that the palm does not touch the table when the patient puts his hand on the table, now it is time to perform surgery. Initially, it is noticed by the hardening of the skin on the palm and forming folds. There are dimples on the skin. The patient does not take it very seriously at first. In general, it is stated that the contraction, the shortening of the skin, occurs at a rate of 1 cm per month. The patients say that they have difficulty putting their hands in their pockets, wearing gloves, or shaking their hands. Although I have said that it shortens at a rate of 1 cm per month, the deformity we see in these photographs is not always the case, and the disease may stop at different stages. Although some publications express that the contraction regresses a little over time, it is usable not to think that it's a state of the recovery. The behavior of the disease can be different for everyone. In some patients, it remains in the palm for life as an unnoticeable stiffness. In others, it can reach a level that can cause difficulties even in daily work, as it causes severe contracture in the fingers. Being young and having multiple fingers are among the factors that increase the need for treatment. Relatively simple methods, such as stretching exercises, medications, or devices are of no use. Although drugs such as tamoxifen, colchicine, and interferon were used in addition to ultrasound and radiotherapy treatments, the results were considered unreliable. In my personal opinion, I do not recommend it to my patients as they will not benefit from medication or physical therapy. Surgical treatment has been the primary method for years and leads to a solution at a high rate. In open surgery, the thickened fascia in the palm is partially or entirely removed. Removal of the entire fascia in the palm is a major surgical procedure, and its popularity has decreased a bit because it is open to wound healing problems and the difficult postoperative period. Instead, relatively more limited removal of the involved tissue is more frequently used. The risk of recurrence in open surgery is 5 to 10%, which is very long compared to other methods. The recovery period is naturally longer. Releasing the fascia with the help of a needle without making surgery is relatively new. Under local anesthesia, the tense bands are loosened from different areas using the sharpness of the needle tip. That is, the bands are cut from the tight parts with the sharp end of the needle. Indeed, it provides a much faster return to work. On the other hand, there is a recurrence rate of up to 80%, especially in young patients. Since it is a blind method, mastery of anatomy is crucial. During this procedure, there is a rare risk of injury to the tendons or nerves of the fingers. Another new method is called collagenase fasciotomy. This is not a surgical procedure. The collagen in the palm bands is chemically broken down. Collagenase, obtained synthetically from a bacterium called Clostridium Hystoliticum, is an enzyme that breaks down the collagen structure. The enzyme injected into the contracted bands is expected to break down the collagen fibers. On the following day of the procedure, the weakened bands are broken by the stretching of the physician. In some studies, this stretching process is also performed a week later. No difference was found between doing it the next day or a week later. These processes can be repeated several times at quarterly intervals. A recurrence is not expected within 6 months after the procedure. A success rate of around 75% has been reported. Very rarely, tendon ruptures and prolonged painful conditions due to the injection going around the tendons have been reported. We call it chronic regional pain syndrome. Between 10 to 20% of recurrences have been reported in 5 years. So let's look at these three methods and how to interpret them. Sometimes patients ask me what you would do if you were the patient. Let's interpret it that way. Although my mind shifts towards the open surgical method, which has been done for decades, I can't ignore the results of needle release and collagenase injection in scientific articles. When we accept science as our compass, we must read the evidence that science shows us well. The fact that the groups are not homogeneous creates a problem when comparing studies on these subjects. So you may have to compare apples and oranges from time to time. Still, there is enough data to compare with each other. Although the early results of collagenase injection seem to be better than the release with the needle tip, we can say that they are not superior. Although the early results of the closed method using a needle were similar to the open surgery, due to the ease of the procedure, this method seems to have more recurrences. You are rightly confused here and want to ask me which treatment would be more appropriate for you. Never choose a treatment method. Do not force the physician to do it. The most crucial factor is whether the physician is familiar with the treatment. You may encounter many problems due to a method that you will force a physician who doesn't have experience. The treatment method in which the physician experiences will be the procedure in which the patient will encounter fewer problems. Knowing the risks of the technique to be done reduces your unhappiness after accepting the treatment. According to the recently written literature, collagenase injection for patients with less deformity or releasing with a needle seems more appropriate for patients with advanced age. The preference of these elderly patients not to undergo major surgical procedure can be perceived as quite reasonable. Limited procedures that can be performed in elderly patients, although there's a risk of recurrence, are more easily tolerated by the patient. In cases where the deformity is progressed, it should be considered that all three treatment methods may have their own problems. Another suggested method is that the beginning should be applied with more limited and closed methods. Open surgery may also be on the agenda if a recurrence occurs within a year. Remember to subscribe and hit the like button for support so that you can see my videos with orthopedics, nutrition, and sports content. May you have active days where you always smile and do not experience health problems.